experienced that the more value that a man has, that the more selections he actually typically have with women. For, I guess, obvious reasons, women have a tendency to be more hypergamous than men. Is it any wonder that a man would actually take a woman working at McDonald's when the typical woman, when she gets involved, she'll say, well, so what do you do? where do you work? Men don't really care about that. Now, I mean, unless it's some loser, right? The only kind of guys that ask that kind of thing, if he's typically planning to live off of the woman, you know? He wants to move in with her, impregnate her, and then have her take care of him. I know guys like that, especially in New York. I've seen a lot of them. But now I actually was responding to what you said. You said that a woman should be willing to lay down her life. Mm-hmm. That's a distinctive thing right there, Tamara. So I'm saying if... So we're going to have to ask you, are you married?
I'm currently married to the father. I was married and I did do what I say. I gave my everything that I had to my marriage. And I can't say that for my partner. So at this time, I am now looking to the father to be my husband. According to Isaiah 54, 4 and 5, he tells us not to be troubled or worried, and that he could be our husband for us in time of that need. And currently I am alone. Well, physically, I would say I'm not really alone spiritually or mentally.
So let me ask you this. Why did that marriage end?
In 2018, after almost 7 years of divorce court. I didn't know back then what I know now, so I probably would have ended it very quickly within weeks of it beginning. But knowing what I know now helps me to help others. It just didn't help me very much.
Yeah, I'm saying, why did it end though? If you was willing to lay down everything for him, what was the reason that that marriage ended? Let me ask you that.
Pardon?
What did you do to cause that marriage to end?
What I did to cause it to end, I look at the being demise of, I had some very serious hormonal problems. And I wasn't always willing to submit myself to my husband when he wanted to have sexual relations with me. And I think that that was the downfall of my marriage, to be honest.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. While you was having those problems, if that man wanted to take another wife, would you actually have been open to that?
I don't think that I would have been open to that.
Why not? And you said that little slogan that you guys say in church. I would assume you got married in church, right?
Or yes,
or something like that. It was for better or worse, right?
Right.
So that would actually make your marriage better. And you're willing, so you're willing to lay down your life, but you're not willing to let him be with another woman.
No.
That's a little one-sided, isn't it?
No, like because I think
high, right? You're a woman of the Most High, right?
Yes.
Okay, if you're a woman of the Most High, do you realize the many instances in the Bible where men of the Most High took more than one wife?
Oh yes, I'm very aware of that. I've studied the Bible extensively.
But you wouldn't have allowed it. You wouldn't have allowed it. But you're a woman of the Most High. But it may have better your marriage.
I think the reason I wouldn't have allowed it is because I don't think it's necessary to have multiple relationships.
Not necessary for who? For you or him? Because you was
neglecting
him. You was neglecting him sexually.
I was, yes. I understand. I learned that. Like, this is a process that I've been through because I've had to go through it, I guess. I learned that I shouldn't have been that way. And I, in part, blame myself for the problems that it created. And but I can't go back and change it. I can only look forward and say, you know, at this time, I'm going to focus on my relationship with the Father and do anything that I can to make that one a better one. And if he should allow me to have someone in my life again, then He's going to pretty much have to smack me on the face. But I, because I'm legally going through a process where I'm completely dissolving all of my marriage, you know, like there's no more, it won't legally be on the record. And I'm just going to remain celibate.
Well, what do you think that's going to help? Hey, for this woman of the Most High, let's edify her. Let's get Genesis 2 and 18. Because you're married to the father, I'm married to the father also. Because remember, the father married, the whole nation of Israel is the bride. It's the bride, right? So no individual woman, that's not what he ordered you to do. In fact, you was ordered to have a husband because it's not good for you to be alone.
That's Genesis true.
2:18. Let's get that, Kadar.
Come on.
Genesis 1:18, you said, brother?
2:18.
2.
The book of Bereshit.
Genesis. Chapter 2, verse 18. And Yahuwah, the supreme Elohim, said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him.
So the Most High definitely designed us not to be like individuals.
This is true.
So if the creator said, I mean, in this right here, this particular verse is written in a masculine form, right? So it's meaning the same thing. If it's not good for the man to be alone, it's not good for the woman to be alone either.
Right.
That's what he's trying to advocate here. So even though you could say you're actually married to the father, he created the woman to be with a man and for a man.
Indeed. It's pretty
clear right there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as far as you denying him, get 1 Corinthians 7, verse 5. Watch this. The scripture, 1 Corinthians 7, verse 5. The scriptures tells you you're not allowed to do that. And then for you not to want him to have another woman, it's utterly off because that causes adultery.
That's where I sinned. I would agree. That's where I sinned, is that I denied myself from my husband.
Mm-hmm. The book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 7, verse 5. Defraud ye not one another.
So he's not supposed to deny you sex. You're not supposed to deny him sex. Got read, okay?
Except it be with consent for a time.
That means you both have to agree to that for a certain period of time. Go ahead.
That ye may give yourselves to fasting and prayer.
So that's for fasting and prayer to better yourselves, afflicting your soul. Go ahead.
And come together again.
And then have sex again after that fasting and prayer. Go ahead.
That Satan tempt you not for your incontinence.
Yeah. Because,
see, the spirit of lust would jump on your husband, and now he's going to get another woman.
Yeah, and that's exactly what happened. And so that's why I blame myself for the downfall of my marriage. Yep. Yes, I'm willing to accept responsibility for it. I know that I caused the problem. I didn't intentionally do it. And when I did do it, when I realized what was happening, it was too late. And I made every effort to fix it, and it just couldn't be fixed. And then I broke my neck and had amnesia for quite some time. And a lot of things happened and changed during that time where I had no memory of things. And then once things started to come back, it was like, oh, no, I can't live this. This to me felt like a lie. And everyone knew but me. And when I found out, it was very devastating, not only to my ego, but to the woman that I am, because I felt cheated.
You say you felt cheated?
Yeah, and neglected. Mm-hmm.
By him?
Yes.
But you didn't deny him sex.
Yeah, I only did it like 3 or 4 times, and then I went to the doctor to find out why I had no desire, because at this point I didn't understand why I didn't want to have intercourse anymore. And looking back on it, he may have already been doing those things. So I'm not really sure if that didn't all psychologically play into it as well. And honestly, the intention to purposely deny my husband was never there. It was just something was going on hormonally. Like in my early 20s, I was diagnosed with a lot of an overabundance of testosterone compared to most women. And yeah, so I've had a hard time.
Do you have a beard? Do you have a beard? I don't remember seeing a woman at my seminar.
No,
with
no, I do not. No, I do not. Nope.
So were you trying to beat him or something?
What I was trying to what?
Were you trying to beat him down or something like that? Because, you know, testosterone make you aggressive.
No, I'm not an aggressive. No.
But I mean, this is why men have aggressive behaviors. It makes you dominant and aggressive.
Yeah, I think I'm dominant. I think a lot like a man in certain ways.
That turns men off. That turns men of value off. Kadal, yeah. Would you be interested in a woman that's dominant?
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Well, what about
yeah,
you?
I've learned not to be
interested in a woman that's dominant?
Nah, no way.
No.
Well, what about you, Fernando?
No, definitely not.
Yeah, no man of status is going to want a woman like that. That's a complete turnover.
Yep, I've learned not to be.
You know what men love about women? Femininity.
Oh, I'm very feminine. I'm very feminine. I think it's more in my thought processes and how I conduct myself that I behave more like a man in some ways. I don't even know how to explain.
That's the problem. See, here's the thing, sis. A lot of masculine women, and this is actually the topic we was talking about, a lot of masculine women would try and compensate for their masculinity by putting a lot of weaves in their hair, overindulging in makeup.
Oh, I don't do any of that.
But they're trying to look, maybe not you, but they're trying to look as feminine as possible. But their personality traits are masculine. And that's the tone of
I'm not like that. Yeah, no, I'm actually very feminine, and I fit very well in the role of what a woman is, I guess. I don't know how to say that. I'm very kind, loving, nurturing. I've actually had 7 babies myself, and I'm very giving. I don't know how to explain other than the fact that I've always thought about financial things in a different way than most women. Like, I've never depended on a man to provide certain things for me. I've always just
masculine energy.
The imagery, yes.
I mean, masculine energy right there.
I got a question because she said that she was dominant. Like, she liked to be dominant, but like, dominant in what? Like, what were the situations where you kind of like took control over the situations? Like, what were those?
Always emergency situations I would take control of, like physical emergencies of anyone. And like if they were having an emergency in front of me, I always take control of that. I always tried to take control of the financial stuff in my life. Later in my years, I did let my husband take that over. We were married for like 8 years before I finally turned that over to him. But I learned, seeing that I came from dominant women, that I needed not be that way. And so I felt that that was really important, that I didn't fall into that trap of trying to tell my husband what to do, because ultimately I wanted him to be the leader in our relationship.
But here's the oxymoron, Tamara.
Okay.
How can you stand here and tell me that you're really effeminate? You know, you sound effeminate. I'll give you that. But
I am.
You're saying that you was dominant. The two things can't occupy the same place at once, right?
Well, maybe I don't understand dominance, because as far as authority wise, I always look to my husband to be the spiritual leader and the provider. If he, you know,
I can't remember you. I'm trying to put a face to this.
I have long blonde hair, and I'm about 5'10".
Can't remember who I was talking to, man. 2019. I can't remember, man.
Yes, I came.
Was your husband there with you?
No. No, I haven't. I have been separated from him since 2012.
I can't remember. What do you have a degree in? You sound,
I have a degree in science. I have a degree in math.
For a teacher. Yeah.
So what type of what was your actual profession when you was with him?
I was for a long time. I was an entertainer, and I'm also a nurse, and
there you go.
I'm a student of the law.
So there you go. All right. So were you actually? Let me tell you something. Tomorrow, one of the worst people that a man could be with in life is a lawyer. Because that's a dominant position. Lawyers actually have to go and take charge, right?
Yeah, I didn't become a student of the law, and I won't pass the bar. So I didn't become a student of the law until about 5 or 6 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So it was after I was with him.
Why'd you do that if you're not going to take the bar?
So that I could help others, so that I could defend. Well, I don't really defend myself. I accept everything. But being in front of a magistrate, I don't want to go in front of a magistrate unless I know what I'm doing. And so I've done plenty of studying as the Lord would lead me.
Right. So, you know, this is what I, actually also have actually, experience. Like, the more educated that a woman is, usually the more problems she would actually have attracting a man that she typically wants, like a man of higher value, because she's gonna usually have a career that she wants to work on, and a man that's a real high status man, he doesn't have a lot of time, because most of his time is going into what he's working on, his business, and so on and so forth, right? So if the woman doesn't have any time, he doesn't have any time, that's not going to work out well.
No, it doesn't.
Yeah, he's going to want her to be there when he, you know, have time to be with her, and that's unlikely because she's stressing her career. So those women usually end up either alone or with a man that they allegedly say that they're settling for, mm-hmm. Someone lower.
I honestly think, in my heart of hearts, that a woman should be at home.
Come on, Tamara.
No. I spent a great deal of my marriage at home. I had 7 babies, and I ran a really tight ship. I've had some brothers actually come to my home in New York, and they spent 2 weeks there, and my house was, from top to bottom, just, I'm very cleanly and very orderly, and I didn't want to go to school. I was doing very well on my own with a small business where I was entertaining, and I worked hours that I chose, which was not very often, once or twice a month, and I was taking care of my young ones, and I really enjoyed it. I was very good at being a mom, a full-time mom and wife and everything that I needed to be. And one day, in the midst of all of these troubles, he says to me, "I think you should go to school." And I was like, "Why?" And he said, "Well, you never know. Something might happen to me. You may have to support yourself." Mm-hmm. And so with this in my mind, I'm like, okay, so what do I do to support myself? Like, what am I really good at other than being a mother and a wife? Like, that was what I was good at. And so I chose to become a nurse because I liked helping people, and I wanted to be an attorney because I didn't know at the time that they're traitors to our country. And because the school was further away, I opted to be the nurse. And so that started me. That perpetuated our problem. Let me just put it that way. Because now I'm going to school full time. I'm exhausted. I'm trying to still raise my family and still be there for my husband, because I actually did a lot of what I call schmoozing for him, for his job. He went from a $45,000 a year job to $110,000 a year in less than 8 years. And I can tell you countless times, year after year, where I went to business meetings and things for him to help.
So he encouraged you to make more money and to help out.
Yeah. Yes. We didn't need help. Like, we owned nice home, nice automobiles, motorcycles, a pool in the backyard. Everything was paid for. Like, we paid for everything with cash, and there was no need for help. Like, I had an income. I made about $2,500 a month, and I had an income coming in, so it wasn't like I couldn't support myself working 3 or 4 days a week, because I could, or a month, I mean. And just the friction that made it worse.
Which part of New York was this?
Pardon me?
Which part of New York?
Oh, I was living in Ticonderoga, New York, in upstate. Yeah, and I had everything. Like, we had the second largest yard in the town. We had the first best house in the town. I mean, we were one of a few people that had pools. Like, I had anything I wanted.
What did your husband do?
He worked for a paper company.
You said a paper?
Uh-huh, paper. He produced paper here in America. Mm. Yeah. And I was happy with my life. Like, I didn't even... I never would have thought in my life that the person that I had trusted with my everything was going to do what he did, but I understand it.
But what did he do?
He went off with another woman and then didn't want
let's hear from other guys. Seth, if your woman was having sex with you, would you stay there and suck it up, or would you go and find it somewhere else?
I will definitely seek another woman.
And these guys think for themselves, Tamara. What about you, Carefoot? Carefoot, if your woman wasn't giving you sex, would you just suck it up and just go and masturbate and break the laws? Or would you go and find someone else?
Yeah, no, it'd be over. That's already happened. No. I'm not going to entertain that. That's right. That's straight out of the scriptures.
Just a yes or no answer. I just want to get, I'm trying to do a poll there. What about you, Fernando?
I would want to be pleased and to get what I want.
Would you stay or would you go?
That's a song, brother. I'm just kidding.
It is.
I might leave. I haven't thought about it. If I'm not getting pleased, then why would I want to be at the place that?
What about you, Jeffy? He's talking kind of soft, man. I think he's intimidated. She must sound attracted or something to him. This act, forgive us tomorrow. What's going to happen to guys sometimes?
I'm going to leave. I'm going to leave and go get me some.
Yeah, and that's exactly what happened. Like, after the third time, he asked me to go find out what was wrong with me. So I did. I genuinely worked at fixing what was wrong with me so that I wouldn't do that anymore. And it didn't help me.
Yeah, I can't hold you. Tomorrow, what I would have told you, I would have been like, listen, since you can't do this, I'm going to bring in a sister wife. If you don't like it, you could leave. I'm not leaving. Right. If you don't like it, you can leave. You know what I mean?
Right. That would have put me in dishonor.
That's what a real man would actually do, man.
Yeah, that would have put me in dishonor.
I get you, but the wifely, you have a responsibility as a wife, right, to, you know, please your husband. And you can't fault him if he goes out. That's a natural order. Sex is a very important element of marriage, unless you're, you know, at an age where it's just not functioning like that anymore.
That's definitely going to cause problems. Right. I think that's why I'm not bitter about the situation, is because I know I had part to blame in it.
Yeah, let me tell you something, Tamora, that your husband probably didn't tell you, your ex-husband, right? Mm-hmm. No man is going to stay with just one woman his entire life, right? And now you intensified that by neglecting him sexually. So, oh man, what's going on with my connection here? By the time that you found out, he probably definitely was already...
Yeah, he was.
You know, yep. Dealing with someone else.
Yep. Yeah, and I would have been okay. I think I would have been okay with it if he had come to me like you say, and then approach the situation by saying, you know what, if you're not going to take care of me, then I'm going to bring someone else in.
And but I would have given you the option. Listen, yeah, we're going to bring a sister wife in. You see how you're not in agree with it? You're not in agreement. You probably would have left anyways. But
yeah, okay. That's what I'm saying. If he would have at least given me the option, but that didn't take place. So that's where I think, you know, I'm not going to be angry and bitter at him. But he also had part in doing with my leaving. Either way, he did, because whether he would have done it the right way or the wrong way, it was done.
Yeah, I mean, it's just best to be honorable. But men are going to, listen, as quiet as it's kept, and most men won't tell you this tomorrow, no man is going to be with just one vajayjay his entire life. It's just facts. I'm just keeping it real with you. If the man that tells you that is lying, the man that tells you that is intimidated, he's not being honest with you, even if it requires him going out to get a hooker or something, at some point, that man is going to go and deal with another woman. He'll try and keep it in the back if he thinks that you're not going to agree with it, but that is in the nature of a man. There's a reason that he could actually get 3-4 women pregnant in one night. It's in his DNA. And a lot of men that's been raised by women, they would try and tell you otherwise because they're trying to go against their nature. But then these are the guys that you see at the strip clubs and, you know, trying to get hookers because it's there in them. It's in their nature. Some men that disagree. I've seen guys on TikTok when I say that they disagree, but eventually they eventually give in.
Well, from what I've seen, it was in the very nature of one that God said was holy. Or how did he describe Abraham?
The friend of the Most High. Abraham was described as his friend.
Yeah. I mean, he made a special distinction between Abraham from the others. Something about how God really favored him.
Yeah, they call him the friend of God.
Yeah. And even Abraham, like, you know, I've had this discussion with many brothers. You know, Abraham had two wives, or he had a concubine at least, Hagar or Hagar, however you say her name.
Yeah. You're absolutely right. But you being a woman of the Most High, what is it that you think that is in your spirit that's rebelling against that?
You mean as far as being a part of that?
Yeah. If your husband wanted to take another wife, why would you, what do you think? That's possessiveness, right? That's
masculine. Well, if you want me to be extremely honest, I could probably say there might be a bit of jealousy there because I'm very selfish in that way. Like, I want to have someone's attention all the time.
You can overcome that though, sis. I mean,
I'm very honest. I'll be honest with you.
But that's good. But listen, that's in the woman's nature to do that, right? Rhea.
Probably. I don't know.
No, not probably. It's a fact. Remember,
I haven't really ever had any friends of, so to speak, of any real substance because I don't trust people.
You said that like that's a good thing.
It's not. Rachel and
Leah was competing against each other.
They were sisters.
Yeah, but they was jealous. Cool. But you could overcome that because there's more good in that than, see, you know what? I could tell you why you're thinking like that. It's westernized indoctrination.
probably part of
That's how our women are raised, and that's a problem. When you go back to your culture, it's the Western world. And but look at it, right? Mm-hmm. Your marriage ended anyways in a divorce. Don't you know that one in every two marriages in a divorce, when it, it's a monogamous marriage, one in every two. So one in every two people to get married is going to end in a divorce. And then 60% of remarriages end in divorce. So it even gets worse the second time. What did Einstein say? To keep doing the same thing over and over and expect different results is insanity?
Yeah.
Maybe it's time that you try it the other way. You might have to become a Christian. Oh,
so
funny. You never know it because there's such a large benefit in that. That if the women would actually accept each other's as sisters and help each other, there's a tremendous benefit in that. See, it's this competitive thing that's going on. And that is, it's supposed to be exactly what it is. Sister wives, your sisters, you're loving each other. You're not doing any fornication, trying to sleep with each other, anything like that. I have threesomes because that's wickedness. That's fornication. But as far as the household, that was actually done to help the community and to help the family to be stronger.
Cool.
But, you know, Westernized thinking has actually, you know, actually engendered into our women, hey, this is a negative thing. It doesn't work. It's proven. Doesn't work for him. He's not us. He's trying to impose his ways upon us. We're just a little different when it comes to that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just have you ever considered trying to get back with him tomorrow?
No. No, why there's not? Been
Well, you said you got 7 or 9 children by him, right?
7. But the problem for me is that not only was I pretty much ripped out of my family's life, I was left pretty much for dead. Like I had a broken neck and a lot of health issues that had happened suddenly, and it all kind of came down at the same time where I found out about it, and then I end up with a broken neck, and then I don't remember for, I think it was like 3 to 6 months before the memory came back that I had just found out what was going on.
Wow.
So he, while I was in a state of amnesia, he continued the farce of only being my husband.
How did you remember that guy, Tazadaq? What's that guy that you saw in Georgia?
Tazadaq.
Yeah, you remember that guy.
How did I come to know you?
No, you remembered him. He's still trying to put a face to you. I can't remember.
Well, I started having my memory of my past life probably about around six months, things started to come back. In fact, just the other day, some things have come back. So... I'm still actually remembering everything that's happened prior to my breaking my neck. But I started studying in 2017 after I broke my back. And
how did all these things happen?
I broke my neck in a car accident, and then I broke my back when I fell in a hole because I lost my balance due to my broken neck. I have an injury in my neck that causes me to lose my balance a lot. So after I broke my back in 2017, I just didn't understand what was going on. And so I did a lot of soul searching, and the Father began leading me down this path of learning about the United States federal codes and just a lot of things, acceptance for value, 1099 stuff, and took me down this path of learning about the law. And in doing so, I was like, I got to figure out what's going on with my life here. Like, I'm living 50% below poverty level. I've got nothing. I went from having living in a beautiful home and having everything I wanted or needed to absolutely in dire straits. Like all of a sudden I was in dire straits and I couldn't produce, like I couldn't go work.
It's like it. Kim Ben, come on the call. What does she mean? Can someone just tell the truth? Kim, come on the call. Come on down.
I was typing the exact same thing in the link.
Kim, come on the call. What is she insinuating, that the sister's not telling the truth?
The truth's an opinion. I only speak that which is true, brother.
Yeah, you know, there's all sorts of personalities out here in the YouTube land.
Truth.
I'm not surprised.
And true.
Kim Ben, come on. Which one of us is she insinuating this lion? Can someone just tell the truth? What's going on? Where did that come from, man? Kim Ben, come on the call. So where are your children now? Boo boo.
Oh, my sons, my oldest son is in New York and my youngest son is in Arizona. And the rest of my daughters are, I think they're all in New York. Well, one goes from New York to Colorado, but for the most part, they're all in New York. One's a model, one's an accountant, so they both travel around.
So your children are adults now?
Oh, yeah. My youngest is 19. Yeah, definitely. Okay. My oldest is 30. I think 36. I'm not really sure. I have to do the numbers, but
you have a pretty young voice then.
Yeah. I'm 54. I had to think of my age. And my 32-year-old daughter just told me today, "You are very beautiful." I was like, "Okay, thank you, daughter."
Can someone just tell the truth? Explanation point, question mark. Kim, Ben, why don't you come on and tell the truth? Because you just lost us with that. Anyone know she's insinuating?
Yeah, because I have really let some walls down and talked about some things that I don't usually talk about with anyone.
I wouldn't take the YouTube comment seriously. Mm-hmm. Trying to engage her. If I took everything seriously that they throw at me, I'd probably be a Looney Tune now.
Right.
I get some serious threats and things in the background. And insults. Just blow it off. Oh. I've been called everything from the N-word to I'll kill you and... Okay. Right. I just say, Roger that. Let me move that from the clip into the chamber. Okay. Wait.
let them take a number and they can line up just like everybody else.
Oh, yeah. And thank you, Brother Tazadaq, because you guys were keeping Purim.
Oh, yeah. Why didn't you show up?
I did.
Huh?
I did. I was in one of your videos for Purim. I was. I watched the whole thing.
Oh, no. I mean, physically.
Oh, I didn't know y'all did that, or I would have.
Yeah, well, come on, sis. We've been doing that for all the hype. Okay, so we're doing Passover. You could show up for Passover.
Yeah, I would.
We'll be in Atlanta. Coming up quick. April.
Isn't it in the end of April?
No. We're doing it on the 8th and 9th.
8th of 9th of April?
Right. Oh, it's coming up pretty quick. In fact, we need to get a venue for that, like ASAP. We need to get a list of who's coming, man, for real. See if the people that reneged last time show up. So you watch that, huh?
Do you have any groups? Do you know any groups in the state of Arizona?
Oh, so you're in, is that where you are now, in Arizona?
Yes.
Oh, I thought you were still in New York. No, we're not, you could fly, just get on a plane to Atlanta.
I can't fly at this time. I have no identification.
Seriously?
Yes.
You have a passport?
It was stolen from me.
You gotta get some form of ID.
Yeah, the actual passport. The U.S. government took it. Yeah, I've been through some really rough stuff this last couple of years. I got arrested last year for supposedly I was speeding, and I've been arrested. I was 135 days in jail. The second day, 2 days later, when they arrested me again, I went to a court hearing where I was supposedly the victim, and they trespassed me and arrested me without ever even giving me any kind of warning.
Which part of Arizona is that?
I'm in Sholo.
Never heard of that part.
That's right by Cody.
It's the east, north side, northern eastern side of this quadrant of the state.
I drove through Sholo with Cody, man. I know exactly where that is. It's on the mountain.
Yeah, I live on top of the mountain.
Okay.
Many moons ago.
That's so neat. Yeah, I like it here. I felt like I was led here.
Well, you need to make it to the Passover.
Yeah, that's in Georgia. ID.
You need to work on getting the ID, sis.
I know. I know.
So what is hindering you from getting it? Like, what's the...
I don't know. I don't know if I'm able to get one right now.
Why not? You could just get a state ID.
Yeah. They took mine here.
You have a birth certificate, huh?
Yes.
You use the birth certificate. So how does it work in, like, in New York, you know how they have the point system? At least in the city, you got to get 6 points to get a driver's license or something. Like, you got to present like a social security card, birth certificate, a different ID, like a banker's card or something.
Uh-huh.
And, yeah, you need 6 points to be able to get a driver's license. Most other states are not like that. You could usually just go in, use like a birth certificate, social, and try to get. I'll tell you right now. Let me see. Have you ever had an ID in Arizona?
Yeah, they took it from me.
What was it? A driver's license or?
I had a driver's license and a state ID, and they took my state ID, and then.
They had both.
Pardon?
You can't have both.
Yeah, that's what they said. I was like, well, obviously I can because I have them both.
In every state. See, that's compacted. You got to agree with your adversary quickly.
I'm learning how to do that now. I didn't know how to back then, even 3 years ago. Like, I've learned a lot in the last year with School of Hard Knocks, but I've learned it.
See. Arizona Department of Transportation. Identification cards.
Yeah, for the state of Arizona. I don't really know if I'm going to be here. I don't even know, but
but you need some form of identification.
Right.
It's, you want to use that stuff like... logically, right? You don't want to use it to, create enemies, right?
Right.
You want to stay in honor when you're using this type of thing. You don't want to, these people put you in some category like a sovereign citizen.
Yeah. Yeah. The judge, actually, I don't call him a judge anymore, but the magistrate, when I was finished with all of this stuff, he said that I'm not arrestable anymore. So I've pretty much learned my lesson, and I did a bunch of bonds and things, and I'm just biding my time, hoping to be fully released from all of this. Like, I'm learning to stand my ground. I've already told them they're not welcome at my property. Don't come here anymore. I've made it very clear by notice and everything, and I feel pretty confident. They've pretty much left me alone. But prior to this last year, in a 2-year period, I was pulled over 18 times, and I had done nothing wrong. So it's been really rough.